Good morning and welcome to worship today. We're glad that you're here with us in the Lord's house on this beautiful Sunday morning. In fact, it's been a beautiful week and I'm really excited about the weekend to come with all of this wonderful sunshine that we've been able to enjoy. I'd also like to take a moment to welcome those who are viewing today via the web stream, and we ask God's blessings to be upon you all as well. As we begin this season of worship, just a few things quickly by way of announcement. Please be sure to pick up the latest copy of the Community Magazine. The new full-color illustrated magazine is now available. You can pick those up in the conference room and also the Narthex. That is our denominational publication. And again, to remind you, as I did last week, we now have the March newsletter available. As we look toward the week to come, please keep in mind the meetings for Monday evening, Trustees, Circle for Christ, Trinity Circle. This coming Wednesday, we have the adult Bible study time here in person as well as online at 10 o'clock. This week, we'll be looking at Revelation chapter 5. And then on the evening, on Wednesday evening, we have middle school and high school youth at 7 with Miss Marcy in Heritage Hall. In just a couple of weeks, it's not in Heritage Hall, or not having, okay? Thank you for catching me on that. I appreciate that. A couple of other things that are not in the bulletin. One is related to our finance committee, our budget meeting. That'll be coming up on the 16th. And then our general board meeting for this quarter is coming up in just a couple of weeks on the 23rd. Marcy, anything that you need to include? All right. Just to give you an update on the blood drive, I shared that on the phone tree early this past week, but we had a goal of 36 donations, and we were able to receive 42, so that is a lot to be thankful for, a lot to be proud of for this blood drive, especially one that came together in, maybe 3 weeks or so, 2 or 3 weeks. It was very quick in the planning process, but that has gone a long way to being successful, so thank you to everyone who was able to give, also to those of you who may be viewing who were able to give as well. Hearing no other announcements,
those who have previously attended Cragmont, you should be receiving your registration forms in the mail this week. I have posted what information I have already to our Reflect Facebook page as well as our church Facebook page. There is going to be some major differences this year. I'm just as upset about some of them as you are, but they are trying to follow the Camp Association guidelines as well as the CDC guidelines. So the CEB will be meeting this week, and I also have some information from Camp Vandermeer and their camp weeks. So as soon as I get all that information compiled, we will have a parents' meeting for all of the kids who are interested in going to camp this summer, and we will discuss what our options are and what to do.
At this time, let us now prepare our hearts and our minds as we worship God together.
He's so good.
please stand and join us in the responsive call to worship. To share whatever gift it is that you have given to us. Gracious God, give us generous hearts. To acknowledge you as the giver of all good gifts. Gracious God, give us generous hearts. To give without counting the cost. Gracious God, give us generous hearts. To share without expecting something in return. Gracious God, give us generous hearts. To be gracious and unbegrudging in our giving. Gracious God, give us generous hearts. To know the freedom that comes with true generosity. Gracious God, give us generous hearts. To be happy with having what we need and to be wise enough to know what it is that we want and do not need. Gracious God, give us generous hearts.
Would you bow with me for our prayer of invocation? Lord, that should be our desire every day that we live and walk this journey of faith. To live not selfishly, to live not so that other people can address our needs, but in order that we might give just as you have sacrificially given to each and every one of us. Lord, open our hearts that we might be a more generous people, not only in this season of worship, but also going forward this week in the different places, the different ministry opportunities where we find ourselves. Let us be eager, ready, willing, enthusiastic to be your hands and feet, to be the instruments of your love and goodness. Father, meet us in this season of worship. Open our hearts and minds to be receptive to the singing of these songs, the prayers, the scriptures, and today's message, that we might go out into the mission field and be your people in the days to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin. He dwelt among men, my example is he. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hands that heal nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified. One day the stone rolled away from the door. saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified, freely forever. And one day he's coming on a glorious day. On a glorious day. Glorious day. On a glorious day.
Our gospel lesson comes from Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly, I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God.
As we go to our Heavenly Father in prayer this morning, I want to draw your attention to the back portion of the bulletin. Isn't it good to have our full bulletin back on this Sunday morning? And hopefully in the weeks to come, you'll be able to follow that prayer list closely. Today, we draw special attention to just a few of these situations and also add a couple of other names. Please remember Ann Hardison and also Kathy Watson, as they'll be receiving some test results in the coming days. Also, we lift up the name of Susan Lucas. She's already on the prayer list. Right now, Keith is doing pretty well, but Susan's been having some health complications. So please remember her during some testing and follow-up appointments that are coming. Also, we continue to remember Thomas Pass during his time of recovery from his car accident. We continue to remember Yvonne Hedgepeth as she recovers from COVID-19. And we also remember Joanne Howell, who took a fall this week. She has improved enough that she's been able to go in to do some rehab, but certainly has a journey ahead of her. So do remember Joanne Howell. Are there other names, other needs that you would have us to mention this morning? Gwen. Anyone else?
Ricky Corbett.
Mm-hmm. perhaps through uplifted hands. God sees each and every heart. God understands the depths of our needs and hurts. Would you bow with me for a time of prayer? Lord, it is so easy to see without really seeing. We may have the physical vision, and that could be 20/20, to literally view something that's going on around us. But at the same time, we can still be so very blind. Lord, we look at others and we point out their situation. So often we become critical. So many times we speculate. Often we point fingers and pass blame. But Lord, you have called us to a higher road, a better example, the path of following Christ. Lord, this path is not always easy. It may run against the grain of our culture. It may very well run against the grain of our human instincts. But Lord, you've called us to be there for others. You've called us to be your instruments. And Lord, if we don't do something, then who will? If not the church in this generation, then who? Lord, to hear this parable is often a reality check. Because, Lord, so often we want to be identified with the good people, the good men and women who get it right, who are sensitive to the hurts of others and seek to address the needs when they are presented. But a lot of times we fall into the other category, what we would call sins of omission, where in our busyness, our selfishness, our careless ways, we fail to do and to be difference makers. Lord, we thank you for the calling that you've placed upon our lives as your church. You've called us to make an impact, to share the good news of Christ crucified, resurrected, and coming again. But Lord, you've also called us to live out your love in tangible ways that make the lives of others different, that make our community a better place, that cast aside evil and darkness and shed the light of your presence all around. God, we thank you for this opportunity to be together as your people. Lord, equip us, strengthen us, give us the resources that we need to better live into our calling, to be your representatives in this day and time, to be willing to count the cost, to be willing to go above and beyond, to be willing to bear our cross daily. God, as we come into your presence in this time of prayer, we think of all of the needs, the hurts that are many, within our church family, within this extended community, within our circle of our personal friends and family. There are many people who are battling various conditions, those who are still faced with and recovering from COVID-19. We think about those who have been impacted by cancer, those with heart conditions, those with broken bones due to falls. Lord, we think of those who are awaiting anxiously test results to come back in the next few days. We think of those going through treatments. We remember those preparing for and recuperating from different surgeries. God, you are our great physician, and it is with confidence that we come into your presence, knowing that you see and feel and understand our hurts and concerns, and that you are a God who is very much willing and ready to make a difference in our circumstances, whatever they might be. Now, the outcomes may not always be according to our will and personal preferences, but Father, you do have a way of working in and through our circumstances to accomplish things that are beneficial for our good and your overall glory. Lord, continue to be with us in this season of worship. And Lord, as we've already heard in the scriptures, as we've already shared through our call to worship, equip us, Lord, to be difference makers. Give us clean hands and pure hearts, but also give us a generous willingness to go forth and to share what we have with those in need. This prayer we lift up in your Son's most precious and holy name.
Lord, we thank you.
Please stand and join me in the affirmation of faith. We believe in the one God, maker and ruler of all things, father of all people, the source of all goodness and beauty, all truth and love. We believe in Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, our teacher, example, and redeemer, the Savior of the world. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God present with us for guidance, for comfort and strength. We believe in the forgiveness of sins, and in the life, love, and prayer, and in grace equal to every need. We believe in the church as the fellowship for worship and for service of all who are united to the living Lord. We believe in the final triumph of the righteous and in the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated, and the children may come with me and Miss Tracy and Miss Ashley and
our sermon text for today is taken from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, as found in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 15. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 15. Today we end one series of sermons to begin another next week. To begin 2021, we've been focusing on, well, the theme, the subject matter of being refocused, because so often in life we get distracted, we get scattered, we get busy, and that's not just within our minds and everyday ordinary life, but even in our spiritual walk with Christ, even in our understanding of what it means to be the church, especially in this generation. We have looked at a lot of different themes over these last several Sundays, one being purpose, the other being a people of compassion, moving from concern toward compassion, I should say. We've talked a little bit about evangelism, what it means to live out our story, because we all have a story of how we came to the faith. We've looked at discipleship, how it's not merely enough to get people on board with church, add people to a church roster. It's about helping people to grow, to nurture, to mature in their Christian faith. Today we wind up this series of sermons by looking at one of the most important elements of being a Christian. Now, maybe there's some overlap with some of the things that we've already talked about over these last couple of months, but I believe it's one that's sometimes uncomfortable. Sometimes it's just ignored completely, it's overlooked, or sometimes it just makes us feel a certain way because, well, we just don't want to deal with this subject matter. And it's in the realm of what we know as generosity. Generosity, giving, sharing, making a difference in the lives of other people. You might say it's a more tangible, even a more specific way of being a people of compassion, like we talked about a few weeks ago. It wasn't simply enough that the Good Samaritan was willing to take notice of the man who had been brutally beaten on his way from Jerusalem to Jericho. But he was willing to get down off of his beast. He was willing to get hands-on. He was willing to even use his own financial means to care for the Samaritan once he was taken to the local inn. Generosity is something that must characterize who we are and what we do as the body of Christ. There's no such thing in this world as a stingy Christian. I shared a comment on Facebook a few days ago that no one ever became poor because of giving. Today, I'm not here preaching just another tithing sermon. I'm not even really talking a sermon today about money. But what I am talking about is giving of the means that God has graced our lives with in a way that becomes beneficial to someone other than just ourselves. May we give ear to the reading of Holy Scripture as found in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have decided or made up in your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it has been written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ and by the generosity of your sharing with them and with others, while they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given to each of you. Thanks be unto God for his indescribable gift. May God add a blessing to this, the reading, the hearing, the understanding, and the living of God's word for our days and times. Amen. Last Sunday, following the worship service, we were engaged in a little bit of lunch table discussion. And I know some of the kids have received the Lent-to-go packs, kind of like the Lent-to-go bags for the adults. Marcy distributed several of these Lent-to-go boxes a few weeks ago to a number of the children and youth within the church family and also in the community. And there are a variety of activities in there to help children connect with the true meaning of the Lenten season as we get our hearts and our minds in order for the coming of Holy Week and Easter, which is just a few weeks away. Well, there's one of these activities. It's a cross, and the cross is about that tall and probably about that wide, and it's a coloring cross. It's one that each day you're entitled or encouraged, I should say, to do something good, something that's positive, that's beneficial for your spiritual walk, that's to help other people and so forth. And so one day it may say, read a Bible story. And so if a child reads a Bible story on that day, he or she will get a crayon, a marker, colored pencil, something, and shade in that particular space on the cross. And the whole idea is that after you have done this for the 40 days of Lent, you're going to have a cross that looks kind of like a mosaic. It looks kind of like a stained glass window, however you want to describe that. But it's a pretty neat little thing, and it gives kids an opportunity to do something positive, to make a difference throughout the Lenten season. Well, there's one particular category on that cross to color in, and it suggests for children to give away some of their toys to help another child in need. Now, having a 7-year-old, you can imagine how that conversation went. Kelsey went to her room, came back out, and tossed a pair of heart-shaped glasses, not exactly sunglasses, but they look like these glasses that people would wear, some of the pop stars back in the 1980s that have these plastic lines across them, and you can kind of see between the plastic lines. Again, just something that's a child's toy, but if you can imagine those being heart-shaped on either side covering a child's eyes. And she came in, as I said, and she tossed them on the table and said, well, here, they can have these. And Marcy and I looked at her, sort of kind of puzzled. Well, that's a start, honey. No, that's all I want to give. After all, I can't wear them anymore. And we looked at Kelsey, and we were kind of gentle, but then again, we were pastors to our own child. And tried to coax, encourage, however you want to say that, the understanding that goes behind giving something. Now, it was, in and of itself, a nice gesture, but to hear Kelsey then go on and talk a little bit more, you'll kind of see where I'm going with this illustration. As I said, she tossed them on the table, said these don't fit, here they can have these. And we said, well, it's a start. She says, no, that's all that there is to it because all of my stuff is too important. I treasure the rest of my toys. And so again, as senior pastor and youth minister, we look at each other, we look at our child, and we're thinking, oh my goodness, this is the one kid in the church that ought to be the role model for doing this to everybody else, even the adults in the church. But in reality, even the preacher's kid's struggling. And it reminded me that that's how life can be. That's how all of us can essentially be, regardless of how young or old we may be, how much we have or how much we don't have. That can be our mentality is, here, take this, I don't really need it. Take this, I don't really want it. Take this, everything else is important to me, so don't expect me to really give up anything that's of great significance. I believe that was some of what the Apostle Paul was wrestling with the believers in Corinth. Especially at this juncture in 2 Corinthians, here in chapter 9, where we have to really set some of the stage for what's going on here. Most of the time when we hear this text, it's not in a sermon or a Bible study or a Sunday school lesson. It's because of the phrasing in there that says, let us give accordingly because God loves a cheerful giver. A lot of times, probably 9 out of 10 times, that ends up being my wording when we typically have taken up tithes and offerings in the worship service, reminding people to give for the right reasons and the right spirit because God loves a cheerful giver. But why in the world was Paul writing such words to this particular audience at this particular stage in their faith journey? Well, to give you a little bit of the background and to kind of set the stage, what we find in the previous chapter and what will come as we read other portions of this letter is that there's a situation back in Jerusalem. There's a concern, a time of need, desperation with the mother church that we would call her. And here we find the Apostle Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, writing out of a situation of need, encouraging the believers there in Corinth who have never seen or heard of or really don't know a whole lot about the mother church back in Jerusalem, for them to be involved through generous spirits in helping address this need that's many, many, many miles away. But if you think about what was going on in Christian history at this particular stage, you know that there was tension between the Jews and the Gentiles. There were those who viewed Gentiles as needing to become Jews before they could actually be Christian. And then there were some who were suspicious of the Jews and tried to say, well, the Jews, that's God's old people. That's the Old Testament covenant. And they really don't matter. They're really not all that important. And so there's always something going on between Jews and Gentiles a lot of times when we read the New Testament. And in an effort to try to break down some of the walls and the barriers that were developing between different groups of Christians, we find the Apostle Paul trying to encourage those in Corinth to do the right thing, to think about their relationship with Christ, and because of that relationship with Christ, to allow that to shape their understanding of God's grace and mercy. In a sense, it's a response to what God has already done for God's people. You have received God's grace, we might summarize Paul saying. So in light of that, you need to do some things that reflect the truth of the changes within you. It was true then, and it's true even for our lives today. It's not enough to simply say we're Christian. It's not enough to simply go to the church services, but we have to offer tangible expressions to what it means to be the people of God. And those tangible expressions have to be making a difference. And that was one of the points that I got across last Sunday when we looked at the text from Acts chapter 2. The fact that there was something noticeably different about the new faith community because the Spirit of God had fallen upon them. They were now equipped. They were now doing some things in light of that that were shaking things up in the community. It was a noticeable kind of difference. That's the same thing that Paul is longing of these believers, but he doesn't want to twist their arm. He doesn't want to browbeat them and say, well, you've got to give because I said give. You've got to help with the mother church back in Jerusalem because I want you to, or else. We also don't find Paul going and making all kinds of really grand promises that if you come alongside of me, if you agree to support the work of the church in Jerusalem, then you're going to get some kind of kickback. Think about when we sign up for maybe a magazine subscription or we've joined some kind of a club. We get maybe a quarterly or monthly magazine or newsletter, and we may get some kind of discounts on certain kinds of things. We get some kind of kickback because we're a member, because we're a subscriber to those particular magazines, to that particular cause, whatever it may be. But we don't find Paul saying, okay, if you'll just join this ministry, if you'll just send this to the church back in Jerusalem, then you're going to get all these great things. We're going to throw in a t-shirt, a hat. We're even going to put your name on a little brass plaque and stick it somewhere in Jerusalem so the people can look and see your name and remember what you did because it's about you. No, Paul doesn't do any of that. But what Paul does try to do is encourage those believers that this is the right thing to give, to share, to be a blessing because God has been a blessing to each of you. And that message continues even in our world today when we look at all of our lives, regardless of who we are, regardless of how much or how little we have, to get up and face a new day. Is to realize that we are a blessed people. And some days we may not think it, we may not feel it, we may not be able to keep up with the Joneses around us, but believe it or not, we are blessed. God cares. God takes care of us. God provides. God comes through in ways that we can't even describe or possibly imagine. And it's as a result of that that God has called us to be generous people. Specifically, as the sermon title gives today, a people defined by generosity. To look up that word generosity in a dictionary, you'll find a variety of descriptions there, but you don't find anything about a person that's selfish. You don't find anything about a person who's out to get all the goods for him or herself. You find that a person is willing to go above and beyond, to do something good so that somebody else's life is better today than it was yesterday. To be generous is to be Christian, and to be Christian is to be generous. But a lot of times when people think of Christianity, they may come up with any number of other definitions. It could be hypocrisy. It could be bitterness and backstabbing amongst people. It could be a secretive club or exclusive kind of religion. But in light of what God has done for us through the death and the resurrection of His Son Jesus, He has called us to be so much better, to do things so much different from the rest of the world around us. And in this text, I believe Paul tells us three things that are very simple, but at the same time are very powerful for who we are and how we practice our faith on a regular basis. The first thing he says here is that generosity takes seriously the needs of others. It takes serious the needs of others. There's no space for me and I in this. It's about other people. When you look at this text, we're told that we are to give generously. We are to give as we have decided in our hearts to give. Not because somebody forces us to do such a thing. Not because we might get something in return. But in order that we might share abundantly. Share abundantly. What a beautiful way to describe that which God has called us to do, to share something. To say, this is mine, but I'm willing to part with it. I'm willing to donate this. I'm willing to give this. I'm willing to not be so inwardly focused on myself and what I want all the time that I want to make somebody else's life better. And we do that because we know that the gospel of Christ has made our lives better. We are capable of giving to the needs, the hurts, the challenges of others around us because of what God has given to us, and God has given us the very best. Amen. God has given us God's all when He sent His Son into the world to be the supreme, full, and final sacrifice for our sinfulness. God, way back in Genesis, spoke everything into being and said that it's good. God's very nature is generosity, giving, the fact that we have life and breath, the fact that we have hope of salvation, not just in heaven one day, but even a new quality of life in the present. That's all God's doing. That's all of God's initiative, and because of that, we should be a people who want to be giving of ourselves, giving of what we have, rather than people who try to cling to every last thing. I think about author Henry Nouwen. He wrote a beautiful little book, very simple read. It's entitled, With Open Hands. And the whole premise behind Nouwen's work is how we so often want to cling to our relationship with God. We want to hold on to it because it's our salvation from God.
and God has given me my life, so I'm going to hold to and save it and protect it for all that it's worth. And what we end up doing is clenching our fists. And that one says, until we can learn to let God open up those hands and allow us to become a giving people again, then we miss the mark of who God has called us to be. Generosity takes serious someone else's needs, their hurts, their longings, and is willing to make a difference by getting involved in their circumstances. It's not about, secondly, giving for our own good. It's not just a matter of making ourselves feel better because, well, I did this and so-and-so didn't do that, or I've been able to do more than what so-and-so was able to do. You see, when it comes to generosity, there's no room for all of that competitiveness in giving. In fact, there's no room for competition in anything that we do as a church, unless we're playing in a softball league or something like that, then maybe competition. But when it comes to being the people of God, it's not about egos. And it's not about, look at me. It's not about having our name and lights, our name printed up on the marquee. It's not about shedding the spotlight on us. It's about giving because God is good. It's about giving because it is to take the higher Christian road in life. It is to take up our cross daily, as Jesus teaches. It is to follow His example of being sacrificial no matter the cost. To be a generous people doesn't just make us look good and feel good. It is good because God is good. The third and final thing that I would say is this: joy should characterize our generosity. I love the wording of Paul here when he says that God loves a cheerful giver. Someone who has the right spirit within them to give because they know that it's making an impact. It's touching somebody else's life. God is being glorified through the giving of whatever it may be. It can be money. It can be groceries. It can be time. It can be whatever, any number of things. But God wants us to do it, to share it, to give it with joyful hearts. Not because our arm has been twisted into it, not because we had to be coerced into doing something good to make a difference, no, but because it's second nature to who we are and what we stand for and what we're about as a community of faith. If we're giving begrudgingly, God would prefer that we just not do it. If we give with animosity in our hearts, well, if I go ahead and do this, then maybe they'll get off my back and they'll shut up and leave me alone. I believe God then and there says, just keep it. Don't waste your time. Don't waste my time. Don't do these things in the name of God's kingdom if you're not doing it in the right heart. But to tie all of this together is that word that I just said, heart. Because generosity can't be forced upon anybody. Generosity is a work that God has to begin in a person's heart. God has to begin that in your life and my life if we are to give. Giving isn't just putting in the offering plate. Giving isn't just filling up a bucket of food. Giving isn't just delivering things to help people in the community. But giving in the right spirit, where God is glorified, starts here with the heart. And when we give in the right spirit, it does a lot of positive things. It points people to God ultimately. There is a God. God is real. God cares. God is concerned. God wants to be involved in my circumstances, no matter how dire they are. But it also has a way of renewing and restoring confidence in humanity. Because we see a lot of things in society today that are just wrecking everything. Things that are wreaking havoc, that are bringing divisiveness and negativity to so many different parts of society. But when we do in the right spirit the right thing that God has called us to do, and we do it with joy, it's a sign that God has changed our hearts. And other people are able to see that people genuinely care, that there are still good people in the world. There are still difference makers in society. What defines your walk with Christ today? What defines my walk with Christ? Is it selfish ambition? Is it self-glorification? It could be any number of things when we're not careful. But may it be our prayer, our hope, our heart's desire today that we can become a people characterized by generosity. I want to close with a story. I may have shared this before, but if I have, indulge me, forgive me. There was a black man who lived on our family farm. My great-grandmother took him in when he was a little boy. His name was Matthew Reeves. We called him Math for short. And he wasn't simply someone who worked on the farm. He was actually an extended part of our family. As in, he would come over to my grandparents when we had moved back in with my grandparents after my dad was unemployed. We would have supper. And just about every night to the week, Math would come over. He would have supper. He didn't want to sit at the table with the rest of us, but instead he insisted upon sitting at a stool at the counter. But yet there was an opening between where we sat and where Math sat as we dined. And we included him in conversation just like he was there at the table with us. Math was a worker. He couldn't read or write, but he could do a lot of things physically around the farm. Math didn't have a whole lot. Math had a single-room house. Didn't even have a bathroom. He had a wardrobe, a little black-and-white television, and a wood stove. But one thing I can say of Math is that Math had a heart. There was a little store just across from where my grandparents' farm was located. And consistently, Math would walk over to that store. He might get him a Pepsi Cola. He might get some chewing tobacco. But he also would bring something back for us cousins, us boys. And I still have these to this very day. They're little baseball cards. And they're not top players. They're nothing that are going to make me a millionaire overnight or anything like that. But they're these little ball cards. They had a machine there at that store where you could put in maybe 2 quarters and it would spit out 2 or 3 ball cards. He knew that me and my cousins, that we were into sports, baseball at that particular time. And he saw that as a way of giving back to us boys. And it may not seem like a whole lot, but guess what? I wouldn't trade anything for those ball cards today. I still have them, and they're still a reminder, not of Math spending 50 cents a pop to get me these ball cards, but they're a reminder of God's love, of generosity being practiced, because that was the nature of who Math was. May the same be said for each of us. Thanks be to God. Amen and amen. As we move into our time of commitment today, Our song of commitment is Take My Life by Chris Tomlin. This altar is open. No matter the needs, no matter the hurts that you're experiencing, this altar is open for prayer. Will you come? Will you respond to the movement of God's Holy Spirit? If you've never accepted Christ and invited Him in to be your Lord and Savior, that is the most important decision that you can make in this life. And it's that starting point that changes your heart and enables you to be a person characterized by generosity. Maybe you would like to renew your commitment to following Christ. Perhaps there are needs, burdens that are really squeezing in on your life at this time, or even thanksgivings that you would like to express to your Heavenly Father. No matter the need, no matter the condition of your heart, this altar is open. As we listen and meditate during this song, will you come?
Let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as You choose.
Have all that we're about and use us for God's glory, to remind people that God loves even them regardless of where they're at, what they're dealing with. May we be characterized by generosity with everything we do and say in this week ahead. My brothers and sisters, it's been good to be with you today in the house of our Lord and Savior. It's been good to worship with you all as well online through our web stream. And it's my hope and prayer that God will richly bless you, lead, guide, and direct you as you seek to be God's servants in the days to come. Would you bow to receive our benediction and the blessing of this week's offering? Lord, we love because You first loved us, and we give in response because You have given us Your all. Lord, let generosity flow through everything that we do, all that we're about, as the church community, and even individually as followers of Christ. Lord, we thank you for this time of worship where we've been able to come and encounter your presence. Now, Lord, help us to embody that presence with all that we say and do in these days to come. Father, we ask that you would bless also the tithes and offerings that have been given or will be given, that they may be multiplied and useful for the ongoing work of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go in the peace of God.